Thanks, Joey. History and social sciences are a key part of what we've been talking about, or we'll be talking about today and tomorrow. And they're playing an increasingly important part at SFI. A couple years ago, maybe 5 years ago now, we had a meeting in Hawaii on laws of history, and the papers resulting from that have just been published recently in a new journal called Cleodynamics, I don't know which pronunciation you prefer, Professor Krakauer. But that effort was one to try and identify what sort of long-term generalities of the kind that we're used to as natural scientists could be applied to historical disciplines. And it was a fascinating meeting because it combined both historians interested in that kind of approach, as well as a number of scientists. Murray and Jeff and David and I and a number of others were there. And that kind of approach, of course, is something that has been part of the Institute for a long time. Linda Cordell, who will present the keynote this afternoon, looks at those sort of issues from the perspective of an archaeologist. Linda's work, her field work and her primary interest has been in Southwestern archaeology. She's very well known as the author of the seminal textbooks on Southwestern archaeology, but has been been involved with SFI really since its inception. And then she was away doing things like running the museum at the University of Colorado at Boulder and helping to run parts of the activities at UNM in reverse order. Before coming back to Santa Fe, she's now a senior scholar at our sister institution, the School for American Research, they've now renamed themselves again, as well as an external faculty member at SFI. I told Linda that I wasn't going to give her a long introduction, but I do want to say that one of the things that I most respect about Linda and her work is that she's very well known as an outstanding mentor to women scientists, not only in archaeology, but in a variety of fields. Through her administrative position, she's had an opportunity to really affect the careers of a large number of young female scholars, and that's really been a tribute to what she's done and has helped not only archaeology, but a number of other disciplines as well. So please join me in welcoming Linda Cordell to talk about revealing patterns in the long durée.
Thank you so much, Doug, and thank all of you for providing me with the opportunity to participate in sharing my research with you and with our outstanding group of postdoctoral scholars here at SFI. It's been a joy to be around them and work with them. So, as Doug indicated, I work here in the Southwest, as does Scott Ortman and many others, and the questions that I have relate to understanding the diverse ways that Native peoples of the Southwest persisted and persist as farmers in an area that happens to be beautiful, but nevertheless arid and climatically diverse and climatically very unpredictable. The Native American crops involved primarily corn, which you see here, and I was actually delighted to know that we are evolutionarily similar people in corn. It's fascinating. Corn is a big thing for me. So corn and beans and squash. And people certainly prospered in cultivating these crops and supplementing their diets with hunting and gathering. And their descendants, of course, are here with us today. The Native peoples of the Southwest share many aspects of their culture, including belief systems, rituals, kinship systems, and yet they are able to maintain great diversity in traditional knowledge and traditional information, and I think that's something that's very important. For example, even among our closest neighbors here in Santa Fe, the Pueblo Indians of New Mexico and the Hopi of Arizona, these people who are culturally extremely similar, from an archaeological perspective, they look almost identical in terms of material culture, nevertheless maintain six different languages. And there are two languages, Piro and Tompiro, which are no longer spoken. This map is actually a map in process, but it gives you some idea of the linguistic diversity. Language diversity often suggests diverse histories, and that's something that's important to the work of both Laura Fortunato and Scott Ortman, and they will be discussing some of that perhaps later. But from an archaeological perspective, the linguistic diversity is a key for me to think about how this diversity in traditional, one kind of traditional knowledge is maintained. And it also makes me think about how we need to look at alternative examples of how information and resources flow among peoples. So my long-term interests have been in learning more about indigenous agriculture and how communities are formed and why some endure and others do not. On the left-hand side of this slide, we have examples of communities that are no longer occupied at Mesa Verde and, of course, occupied communities today at Taos Pueblo and on the Hopi Mesas. So by enduring, I think I should explain what I mean by long durée in my title. Archaeologists see stability and change not over decades, but over centuries. Change is not necessarily, the change that we note is not necessarily noticeable within human lifespan. So for archaeology, the long durée is not the long durée of paleontology, but it's also not the short time frames of ethnography and even history. So my particular research and my interest, I focus on the period from about 1140 to 1640 CE, about 500 years. Settlement shifts in the Southwest occur periodically, and they're a major focus in the region. But when we look at changes in population and we look at changes in population over time, we must concern ourselves with how the techniques and methods we use for measuring population. It's an extreme difficulty for us. We don't see people. We see structures. We see basically ruins. There's been a great deal of very exciting new research in this regard, and while I worry about numbers of people all the time, I have great confidence in the kinds of new measures that we have, many of them developed by people who've been working with SFI, for example, the Village Ecodynamics Project, which Scott Ortman had a lot to do with, and some of the population estimates come out of that. Also work that's done, has been done out of the communities, Coalescent Communities Project in southern Arizona, a number of people working on that as well. The other key issue that is important if I'm interested in the duration of agriculture and different kinds of agricultural techniques is understanding the changes in the environment. And that is something, again, that has had a long history development in the Southwest and has depended largely on one thing, not one thing entirely, but the work of the Tree Ring Lab in dendrochronology, which allows us to date occupations because trees were used as building material and timbers, but also provides methods of paleoclimatological reconstruction. And again, those have been developed largely through cooperative work, some of it done here by George Gummerman and a group of people that include Jeff Dean and Carla Van West. And projects such as started out with artificial Anasazi, but even its predecessors, the Anasazi in a changing environment, has gone on to improve. So both of those things have been critically important to anything that we're doing right now. The realities of the Southwest and Southwest archaeology is that residential permanence of any kind was unusual. And there is depopulation, residential movement at different scales. So single dwellings or field houses, and here you see a Zuni waffle garden and associated structures, may only have been used and had use lives of a few seasons. Localities or small valleys, mesa tops and moving from mesa tops to valleys, were occupied episodically for a period of a few decades or perhaps a century, then not occupied for quite some time. One of the classic cases of this is Cedar Mesa in southern Utah, which is considered some place that was occupied episodically, or as its excavator commented, it's a boom and bust sort of cycle. People are in and out of there all the time. Because of the climate vagaries of the Southwest, we tend to see these sorts of small movements as being primarily a result of people moving their fields to places where they have better climatic conditions and those changed. But in fact, now recent research by Phil Gibe and some others have pointed out that the same sort of episodic occupations were true for hunters and gatherers in the same areas. Finally, there's kind of the notorious, I think, depopulation of regions. Unfortunately, regions are vaguely defined, but would include, for example, the Mesa Verde area. This is agricultural peoples, late 1275 to 1300 about. And then later on, so we see major depopulations of, for example, the Mesa Verde area, the central Mogollon Mountains, which are in here, and large portions of southern Arizona. So not only were regions depopulated, but the pattern is one in which they are depopulated at different times and at different rates. So that's something that we need to consider. Analytically, we need to separate depopulation of a single site from depopulation of localities. However, it's possible that their dynamics are interrelated, and I think that that's something that I certainly have not investigated, but something that we should and that we might want to do that. Looking at the regional depopulations, however, in the Southwest, these occurred in a spatially transgressive sort of way. So they start out in the West. This is a terrible map, I apologize, but to give you an idea, they start out over in the West in just about the tip of Nevada, and this is the muddy and virgin area. And then this is no longer populated by about 1200. Somewhat later, by 1300, northern Arizona and the Mesa Verde region is depopulated. Somewhat later, by 1450, southern Arizona, a large part of southern Arizona, and a large part of the Mogollon Mountains are depopulated. So it's time transgressive in that regard. For a stunning example, Mark Varian estimates that while 10,000 people left the central Mesa Verde region within 25 years, between 1260 and 1285, so that was just really rapid, massive movement. On contrary, the Tucson Basin, the Ho-Khan population, which is estimated to have been about 140,000 people, declined to zero over 300 years, between about 1150 and 1450. The two examples are interesting for many reasons, especially because the people involved had two entirely different agricultural and settlement systems, and I think that's something that we need to think about. So, for example, in the Mesa Verde region, settlement instability was common. People were in and out all the time, and they were depending primarily on dry land agriculture, so the amount of precipitation was critical. Nevertheless, in the Ho'okam area, people did irrigation agriculture. There's long settlement stability. People were there for a long period of time. Nevertheless, both regions were, in fact, depopulated, and depopulated at different rates. So, and I would want to point out that the reasons that given and the are potentially interrelated, and I think that this is, again, not insignificant. As this area, the western area, was gradually depopulated, or was depopulated at a certain period of time, people began moving toward the Mesa Verde area and also wherever else they could move, and we'll talk about that in a minute, where one goes being rather significant. It was easier, perhaps, to bring people into an area where irrigation agriculture was already established and they could contribute their labor and be incorporated, whereas there were difficulties in incorporating additional people in the Mesa Verde region, which is dependent on dry land agriculture. Interestingly, the pattern, so what happens is that you have aggregation of population in areas that were accepting people, and the aggregation had different outcomes. In the Mesa Verde area, clumping of people together was a long-term process, and it resulted, in fact, in a lot of warfare, in violence, and the eventual dissolution of the system. In the Arizona area, by contrast, they seem to have been able to incorporate immigrant communities relatively more easily. The pattern of aggregation and the formation of multi-ethnic communities leading to population decline has been seen elsewhere in the Americas. And so while we tend to see this in the Southwest as in our little microcosm, this is something that, again, needs to be compared, I think, over any number of regions. So for example, it was noted in the southeastern United States in the early historic period, and then to me, very interestingly, in the Oaxaca Valley of Mexico by Steve Kovalevsky, who noted, there's no way that you're going to be able to read this, and I apologize, but the heavy, the darker images are simply denser populations, and they move around the Etla Valley. In terms, it may actually be a Pan-American phenomenon of having high aggregated populations not staying in the same place, and certainly I would hope that some research is done that looks at that situation in broader terms. But meanwhile, back to the northern Southwest and the Mesa Verde region. Here's an instance in which Kohler and Varian and a number of scholars argue that population aggregation led to conflict, and there was also there was diminution of resources, but people attempted to compensate for this. Turkeys were actually domesticated, perhaps even there, but we have a new domestic species that was used heavily. But even with this technological innovation, it could not sustain population growth, and people left. Mostly, they went to places where their numbers could be absorbed, and that's those regions possibly where gravity-fed irrigation was possible, but they also left perhaps to get out from under a climatic perturbation that I'll explain in about 2 minutes. Both of those seem to have been rather important. So let me talk about the climatic perturbation very, very, very briefly. The modern precipitation distribution in the Southwest has two different patterns. There's a pattern in which you have two precipitation maxima a year on the west and a single precipitation maximum on the east. This pattern shifts over time slightly, and you can notice this pattern if you are watching the ski reports for this area, because they're often tell you where the snowfall is. This is a pattern that we have today. One of our colleagues, Jeff Dean, has noted that when he plots tree ring data for retrodicted precipitation over many centuries, he finds that there's actually a very similar pattern that seems to have been stable for a very long time. Then from the period between about 1250 to 1450, there's a chaotic pattern, which would mean that any social relationships that one had at that time would in fact have been disrupted. So an argument is made that people perhaps moved to areas where they had connections that had enabled them to buffer that pattern, and that was also places where gravity-fed irrigation might be possible. The suggested social interactions, and we'll get back to this in a minute, are noted through ceramic traditions, pottery, which are basically similarities in style, which suggests that there was communication between one area and another, but it's more complicated than that. So a few years ago, a number of us, including Jeff Dean, Carla Van West, and I, tried to look at this and to see, in fact, whether, given the chaotic rainfall pattern, people would go to places where they had long-term established relationships that compensated for the differences in these patterns, and suggested that perhaps people moved from the Mesa Verde region into this area, which would have been below the area where the chaotic pattern existed or came into existence. And in fact, we compared actual annual precipitation in both areas, and it's a work in progress that I think is still useful to look at, but nevertheless not a complete solution for reasons that you'll see in about a minute. So aggregation has been implicated as a cause of population decline, particularly in the Mesa Verde area, where it led to all kinds of conflict. In the southern Arizona area, it seems not to have led to conflict, but there were health problems in aggregated communities, and population declined more gradually, but probably due to resource stress of one kind or another that were not compensated for. And the whole issue of aggregation, in fact, may be one that is, you can't sustain those dense aggregated populations in one place in the Americas. However, I think we need to look at the receiving end, and this is rather more critical in terms of some of this. We tend to think about, oh, these huge places that were depopulated in the past, Pueblo Bonito, Chetrocatl, each had 700 rooms. There are all kinds of people who work in Chaco Canyon who debate endlessly whether those sites were occupied continuously or not. I have no opinion. I don't go there. One of the larger sites in the Mesa Verde region, Sand Canyon Pueblo, 400 rooms. Cliff Palace, the largest cliff dwelling at Mesa Verde, 220 rooms. As soon as you get down here, after the major depopulations to the north, we don't lose aggregation at all. We have Sapali, which is the largest adobe ruin in New Mexico. It covers about 70 acres and had over 2,000 rooms, so it's huge. And Sapali was not alone. In fact, from the far west at the Homolivies, which is our ancestral sites to Hopi, over 1,000 room pueblos, as far east as just the edge of the plains at Gran Quivira, another 1,000 roomer. And there are many, many, many sites. So aggregated villages did not disappear. And a key question for me is, how were they sustained in the absence of apparently the development of social hierarchies? What kind of information exchange and what kind of resource exchange are implicated? back to this map simply because we look at exchange and interaction through similarities in ceramic style, which may not be a good proxy for that at all. One of the first clues we got to that was some wonderful work by Patricia Crown about ceramics and ideology, in which she basically pointed out that there are certain icons that appear in pottery at a time period that she was dealing with that cross-cut the basic typological similarities that we use. I love this example. I don't know how distinctive what they call pendant parrots are, parrots hanging upside down. But these two pots, this is a black and white pot that is of one ceramic tradition. This is a glazeware shirt of another. The people may have belonged or carried the same ritual belief system, participated in similar rituals that helped them integrate across these stylistic zones. But this has to do with ideological or information that is perhaps encoded in symbols, but not necessarily relate to exchange of goods. To get to that, I think we have to look at some work that was done many, many years ago by Anna O'Shepherd, who is someone I refer to as Saint Anna, and I don't do that lightly. But if you look at pottery from the outside, you basically see lovely designs, and if you look out from the inside, you see minerals that are used as temper. Anna systematically used optical petrography to identify the mineral constituents of ceramics, and they're beautiful. And she was able to identify the mineral constituents and relate these back to the mineral sources, then to the pottery, and find out that, in fact, pottery was moved over enormous distances and not in small quantities. She did this in 1936 first crack out of the box, really kind of saying, well, let's see if it works. She was offered the opportunity to study the pottery of Pecos Pueblo, and she was made that offer by Alfred Vincent Kidder, who was the dean of Southwestern Archaeology. He had just completed his major work on the pottery of Pecos, in which he had described the styles as developing as a household craft. Anna Shepherd looked, that's why she looked at 957 thin sections, far more than we would ever do today, because she discovered that over many periods of time, the pottery of Pecos had not been made there, but had been made on the Pajarito Plateau, some couple of hundred miles away. This led to Miss Shepherd's bombshell, which was Kidder's announcement, really, that her discovery had changed the course of Southwestern archaeology, that she had been able to show that there must have been overproduction in one area, mass production, and then movement to another area. Enough had been said. Basically, she destroyed his research. However, she was systematically ignored. So we really haven't paid that much attention to the fact that pottery was moved over vast areas, and that's an interesting way of thinking about the relationships among these communities. Recently, literally within the last year, we've been able to demonstrate, Carrie Schleyer at the University of New Mexico has been able to demonstrate that pottery was in fact overproduced in certain sites at certain times. It's a hard thing to demonstrate, but she's done that. One of the implications of this has been brought about recently by Tim Kohler and his work on Bandelier. And as you know, Tim has been involved here at SFI for many years. And he proposed that in the sites that he was looking at on the Pajarito in Bandelier National Park, that in fact we had commercialization in terms of markets, that communities develop specialties. He has good examples of specialties in lithic stone tool production, perhaps growing cotton for textiles, and perhaps raising turkeys. He doesn't have his ceramics production area yet, but there are people who are working on that. And that producing having market exchange would allow communities to develop close social relationships that would help them band together in times of warfare, and that's certainly true. Perhaps there were markets. We had never thought that was even possible to look at. I suggest that when you're moving hundreds of pots over 200 miles, not only are you creating relationships that would be good in warfare, but you're also demonstrating perhaps some peaceful relationships in that you wouldn't do that if highway robbery were a consistent problem. But we need to look a little bit deeper, I think, in terms of exchange, and that's something that we're able to do because of advances largely in techniques. Some of the pottery that we look at is decorated with a glazed paint. The glaze is made from galena, from lead, and there are only a limited number of lead sources. Lead sources can be differentiated in terms of lead isotopes and particular mines identified. This is has been critical in terms of what we're beginning to do now. As a very, very, very striking example, Suzanne Eckert and Deb Huntley, particularly, and my colleague Judith Havoc-Mosch, were able to show that the earliest lead-decorated pottery that we have in the Southwest, which comes from the Pueblo of Zuni, and so here are some early types of Zuni pottery, was actually decorated with lead that came from the mines at Cerrillos near Santa Fe. So to give you an idea, Zuni is about over here, and Santa Fe is over there. They're obtaining lead sources from great distance to use on pots that they were making at Zuni, and those pots, of course, were then often transported to other areas. Over time, they start using lead sources that are closer to Zuni, so it wasn't that there wasn't any lead in the vicinity, but this shows a network of interaction that is, in fact, considerably greater than what we had thought existed. So when we look at production, I think we're looking at networks that involve raw material acquisition, and then we're looking in the subsequent products at exchange of really large amounts of material over great distances. So in order to investigate that further and kind of what am I doing with my spare time now, I went back to a site that I worked on 30-some-odd years ago in Tijeras Canyon for a couple of reasons. It's the earliest site in the Rio Grande Valley that actually produced lead glaze paint, painted ware. And it's also a site that's extremely well dated by tree rings. So there are over 360 cutting dates for the tree rings at that site. We know exactly when certain rooms were built. We also can do excellent paleoclimatological reconstructions. And we have found some very, very interesting things. The earliest glazed type pottery there is unmistakable from Zuni pottery, cannot be differentiated unless you do INAA analysis, which we are currently doing. And we are finding some interesting things. Some of the decorated pottery is absolutely fascinating. It has Zuni decorations on the interior, Rio Grande decorations on the outside, and this one was used to process malachite. It's a malachite mine right behind the site. The site itself has a contemporary Zuni shrine right behind it and is known as an important place for Zuni people today. It's in a very lovely setting at the foothills of the Sandias. So first of all, Carla Van West has, bless her heart, done some paleoclimatological reconstructions to see if people from Zuni might have been attracted to going to Tijeras because they were experiencing different climatic patterns. Were there differences going on that would have made an alliance useful? She just gave a paper on that at the SAA meetings 2 weeks ago. And in fact, discovered that there are some interesting problems. We're going to continue this research, but one of the problems is that the climate reconstructions involve trees that come from the same forest. You can't quite differentiate them, so we're working on that one. That will happen. But it looks like some of our ideas about climate are in need of refinement. The other thing that we're doing is my colleague Judith Habich-Mosh now has a substantial NSF grant, and she's analyzing every potsherd from Tijeras Pueblo. What we're learning is that some of this pottery was in fact made at Zuni with lead from the Cerrillos mines, and then the pot itself was deposited at Tijeras Pueblo, which is outside of Albuquerque. So again, a very interesting network of movement. What would I want to do next with some of this? Well, one of the things that I would like to do is to get away from doing typological analysis of pottery and kind of follow the lead of Matt Peebles, who's in Arizona State University finishing his doctorate. He gave this paper a couple of weeks ago at the SAA, which suggests that the use of network analysis might be really interesting here because in his area, and I'm not going to explain his chart, simply to say that he was able to show considerable stability in technological attributes in populations at Zuni Pueblo by separating the technological attributes of ceramics away from the decoration. And he could also identify an immigrant group when they came in. And what I would like to do is start looking at networks of resource production and resource exchange and extraction, and how diffuse those were depending upon the size of the settlement. So the kinds of things that I think that's offered by the scale of data that we have for the Southwest now and where things are going is, I really think that looking at the potential synchronicity of population movement might be interesting. I think we should look at the Pan-American phenomenon of local and regional depopulation in the absence of climate factors. These may be hemispheric and potentially interesting. I think we need to address when, in terms of what scale, problems of resource deficiency are mediated by technological innovation, for example, domestic turkeys work to sustain growth, and when things like that don't work, even though we're at fairly low levels. I also think that looking at other ways of looking at stability and growth, looking at different kinds of efficiencies of exchange, whether we're dealing with local markets or not, is also an important issue. And I think that how knowledge diversity, how traditional information, whether it's encoded in language or whether it's encoded in other mechanisms, how that is sustained in multi-ethnic or multilinguistic communities which potentially have different historic backgrounds, and how people can come together without necessarily being hierarchically organized. So basically, I think the maintenance of diverse knowledge in aggregated communities is something that is useful. So I think a lot of the topics that may be of use to us are things that certainly Scott and Laura and Ann and others here will have quite a bit to say about and will be relevant to their research. And I'm happy to answer any other questions that you might have. Thank you. Any questions? I will point out, if you're curious about what these guys are doing, they have just found a source of mica schist temper. They are so ecstatic. No, dead silence.
Linda, do you discount then drought as a key factor?
Absolutely. How do I say this? A couple of things. In terms of the regional depopulation. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So, first of all, the people, we've known this for a very long time, the people from at Mesa Verde and others of those areas in which the great drought is implicated, suffered through droughts that were very severe long before that one. So they have made it through that. What seems to have happened is that, and I think Tim Cole agrees with this, he certainly has commented on it, that you can make it through drought as long as you can move locally. But once your population is circumscribed, once you have aggregation and mobility, it becomes limited. At that point, you have no alternative but to leave. So it's not the drought per se. The other thing that I think is relevant to this is the comparative example. And I know that I didn't make as much of this as I should in my comments, because I was trying to save time. But in fact, if we do have the same phenomenon of regionally populations moving around, which we seem to have in the southeast, and we certainly have in the Valley of Oaxaca, which is a very resource-rich valley, and certainly one where droughts were not that kind of phenomenon, then a drought per se may have been important in a particular region, but it's not addressing an overall problem, and one that I think we need to look at more systematically in a broader scale. So these are population dynamics as a whole, I think, would be my answer to that.
Linda, you talked about low level of technological innovation. What strikes me is there was tremendous innovation socially and politically and ideologically, mm-hmm. but the amazing thing to me that there was virtually no technological innovation.
Right.
They went from trough metates, where for grinding the corn, to those metates in bins. For 1,000 years, there was virtually no technological innovation.
Well, this is a really good point. I think. I would like to comment on two aspects of that. The low levels of technological innovation, for example, the use of domestic turkeys, give us one that might have done something. And if people are reducing the amount of protein, their areas are overhunted, turkeys weren't apparently enough. The other kinds of innovation that we do have technologically are various kinds of various kinds of water and soil control, farming technology, which is actually extremely useful and variable. So for example, I don't know whether I can find this all that quickly, but I would certainly like to do this for a minute, just a second. I'm sorry to click through this. Bear with me. Okay, we got it. No, we don't. No, we do. No. One more. Okay. So, sorry, I did not point this out. So these are terrace systems that were used extensively in the upland areas at Mesa Verde. By the time you get very dense populations down here, one of the technological innovations are gridded fields. These cover acres and acres and acres of lands. And what they do is two different kinds of things. They act as a mulch, so they are conserving moisture, which is an important thing. But because they're made of rock and they often have gravel on their surfaces, they're moderating temperature at ground level. So for example, this area in New Mexico that actually has one of the shortest growing seasons is up on the Chama, which is just north of town. Out here, and we have evidence that they were growing cotton in these fields on the Chama. So the technological innovation was an agricultural innovation, but not one like irrigation agriculture on a massive scale that would have provided for really dense populations. So in that sense, less. However, the fact that these did what they could, and in some cases they're not enough, also suggests that it was far more the social and political and ideological and information networks that allowed the maintenance and stability of those very large population aggregates, for example, the several hundred thousand people that were probably living in the Galisteo Basin, which is almost unheard of. So this is about innovation in information exchange. And that's basically the conclusion that Kowalewski came to with regard to Oaxaca. We're not talking about major technological change, we're talking about political and economic innovation.
Thank you.
Thank you.